Really nice to see you all here today, despite the weather. I at least felt like a sort of drowned dog in while biking here. So it's nice to be in an uplifting and nice environment at the moment to be talking about open science. I am working at the University of Helsinki, as most of you, I suppose, at least who are participating here, and I come from the Department of Geosciences and Geography. And I'm there an assistant professor, a tenure track professor in geoinformatics, and have been, of course, teaching for long and then doing research for long. And I'm fairly keen on using different sorts of big data sources, open data sources, for our research on spatial patterns and spatial phenomena. I think that I'm maybe standing here, so is it better this way? Yeah. And I've been fairly active since maybe year 2000 or something in openness, in the sense that at that time spatial data sets and the openness of spatial data sets started to be a big issue in the administrative field of Finland. There were directives coming on in the European Union that were saying that spatial data sets, so maps, statistics that have spatial reference and so on, that they need to be available throughout the administration. And at that time, we as researchers started to think that we should be having access to these really valuable data sets that are published by our authorities, but actually are very expensive and were not at that time in the reach of us. And we were working quite a bit to be getting access to this administratively created data set. And in the end, it has happened that in Finland, most of the spatial data sets, all maps produced by National Land Survey, all environmental spatial data sets produced, or at least almost all, produced by Finnish Environment Institute, Geological Survey of Finland, you name it, a number of institutes, have been sharing their data sources openly and freely for the research use, but also for everyone in the society. And at that time when that happened, which was really a sort of crucial big thing for us as researchers, we started to be talking also, of course, about open science. So what is our responsibility of sharing our work? So as we had been making claims that everyone else who's working on public money needs to be sharing their things, so then the sort of mirror came upon us, and we started to think that, okay, indeed, we are also data providers, we are also those who are creating results, we are sort of making important work, so of course our work also should potentially be open. And there was the open science movement happening at the same time, but this was sort of an eye-opener to me to be seeing the open science movement and our efforts on releasing other people's data, so that we too should be working on our own field. And I've been part of thereafter in different open science initiatives, for example the actual Open Science and Research Initiative by the Ministry of Education and Culture, and participated in many other discussion groups, for example those which come from the researcher field. For example, Open Knowledge Foundation has an open science discussion group where we have been trying to advance things from the root level upwards. But this is of course not my sort of main work. I don't work to promote open science or to try to advance these things. It's a necessity that we have to do in order to carry out our work, and my actual work relates to research, education, but research especially on accessibility patterns in urban regions in different parts of the world, but mostly recently in Helsinki region, and then in analyzing also natural patterns. I've been working with group called Conservation Biology Informatics Group. Both of them do and use really advanced methods, open data, try to advance sharing their results and advance spatial planning so that we could be developing more sustainable societies. And just so that you know that this is my background, because of course many of my examples come from these two projects. Then there's a new one with social media data that Eva was referring to, and we are bringing these two things together and using social media data as one source of information there. But somehow when working on issues of accessibility, land use, transportation, land use change, biodiversity threats, and so on, things which are very crucial in the society, it somehow has become evident, of course, that these really big issues, like our planetary boundaries at the moment, which we are sort of overing all the time, we are sort of consuming more than we have. And that is a big thing. So that requires scientific answers, scientific knowledge, scientific actions that we could be fighting these things happening. There are very sort of big issues happening quickly in the world, also in terms of, say, urban environments where we work, the new driverless vehicles are coming. There are new phenomena in the society which happen and surprise us all, that what is really happening in here. And researchers, of course, should be somehow the watchdogs or the, those having the nose for new things and understanding what is happening when such big things happen. And we should be able to be providing some answers to these big things happening around us, and not only sort of in the time lag of, say, 2 years, what the publication might take. We should be quicker in being reactive, in being able to say something. And of course that means also that as issues are really complex at the moment in the world, and they are sort of speeding up, it doesn't help that there's sort of increased number, like really skyrocketing number of publications being published. There's more researchers in the world than ever before, unless we are able to really tackle these questions which are happening within our society and to our environment. And therefore, somebody said, when I started as a researcher, somebody said that we are all sort of private entrepreneurs here, that everyone needs to be thinking just sort of to be playing their sort of cards in a wise way so that we can secure our future as researchers. And somehow I think that is sort of striking difference between the real questions that we have that we should be answering and then the researcher career at the moment. And that is something where openness then hopefully comes to play. And with open working methods, open working practices, we might be actually become not private entrepreneurs, but private, or not private, but common big groups who could be advancing and addressing these big issues. That's of course the goal of all of us, I suppose, who are doing research, but still it's happening that we are doing things in a close manner, trying to compete over each other in the funding and merit system that we have, and that maybe prevents us from doing things in such a way that we would be solving some of the questions of the world. And that is of course something where open science comes to play. One of the big things here is at the moment also that we have more data available for our research than ever before, and that is something that I and many others in the room as well personally face, that there's more data sources available for research, there's more possibilities to be doing research which is really sort of observing the current development of things, for example social media data sources, but that is only one example. So thinking about the big picture, the big questions that we have been and are facing all the time, and the need of being able to react rapidly, open science has been thought as one answer to that challenge. That indeed, if we would be sharing our results, so publish openly, others would have access to our research results, isn't it? And that is like non much debated anymore. We know that publishing companies or scientific publishing is one of the most lucrative, one of the sort of best business model in the world at the moment, for the reason for the reasons that we all know. The prices are very high for scientific publications, and researchers are doing most of the work for free. And still libraries from the same research institutes are buying the results of our work back. And in that sense, the work that libraries have been doing and researchers have been doing in trying to promote open access publishing is very relevant and very very sort of non-debatable from our point of view, I suppose. We all, I think that this is an important field to be advancing, and it has been already advancing very well. Then, thinking about more our work as researchers, where I'm concentrating more today, is of course in the open method side, that if we want to be really publishing openly our results, our work, so then publishing also our methods would be needed. The text is not yet enough. So that is available then for others, but to really, in these complex analysis situations, for example, that we have, so then sharing our methods in a written text is not possible. So we need to be also sharing our methods. And of course, if the methods or if the analysis is based on data, so then having understanding on what the thing was that the analysis was based on is crucial. So we need to be building our work on open data as well, in order to ensure quality control, reproducibility, transferability of our results. And this is how usually the thing is being addressed, as you know. So this is, I suppose, not new to many of us in the room. So three things need to be gaining attention. But somehow I've been fascinated, in addition to this three-stage division, to a circle model which has been presented in various circumstances. For example, in the Open Science and Research Initiative, it has been drawn this way, but there are other drawings of this as well. So how openness could be taken to the whole research process. So not only when you're at the end of the work and you think of publishing, so then you think that, okay, I need to be publishing also the methods and the data and so on. But how do we really make the work open in such a way that it could be starting from the beginning, that already the questions that we try to address would be discussed potentially with broader group of people, we would be answering maybe to relevant questions, and how the whole circle from beginning to the end, or the whole world of science could be open. This is a big thing and not easily solved, but small things have already been made in various different locations. And I thought that now within my presentation I would go through some examples of how small steps could be taken to achieve the openness of the whole research process. Today, as you have in the afternoon, the discussion groups, which are sort of aiming, to my understanding, to practical results and practical thinking on how things could be advanced. So then I hope that some of these examples would be supporting on that. First of all, if we think about the whole sort of examples where the whole research process would have been open, it depends pretty much on the field. Not all fields need to be fully open, or you don't always need to be testing your questions first with others in order to make relevant research, of course. But in some very practical applied research fields like ours, that is possible. But then also in very theoretical, of course, doing the entire research process openly is possible. Then just the participants vary, that who are part of that open process. How many of you have heard about the Polymath project? Is it something that everyone knows? No, okay. It's something which started from the University of Cambridge 2009. There was an idea or a mathematical problem that had been unsolved. And the idea was that in case we try to be solving it within the research group, it will take too long. And there are sort of huge number of research group who have been tackling with the same problem throughout the world, who are rather competing against each other than working together. And then the founders of the Polymath project in Cambridge thought that if we place the question online and invite best research groups or all the research groups to be contributing to answering that question, we might be able to answer the mathematical question that was at hand. And then, of course, they were sort of well-known researchers. They invited other research groups, presented the equation challenge in online created a platform where discussion could be taking place, and in the end we're able to answer to the question that was thought to be too difficult to answer. And they have been thereafter expanding their work a lot. They have, for example, high school projects, so similar crowd math ideas for high school students. So they place a question online and several different groups try together at the same time be answering to that challenge and contributing so that all the contributions are visible online. So everything that happens, happens openly, happens visibly. And for example, if we think about the classic merit problems of scientific world, it's clear that who has been contributing and in which ways when the whole process is available there. This doesn't fit to many other fields, but to some field it matches really nicely. And for example, in Aalto University, the NMR lipid project has been applying the same approach in Finland and has been led by Samuli Ollila and has been really nicely been able to tackle these same questions of openness, the same questions of merits and to be able to, or it has been able to test how such a thing should be and could be advanced. We ourselves haven't been at this stage. We haven't been posing questions online yet. We hope to do so, but this hasn't been something that we would have been able to do because of probably practical limitation and excuses. So it will be interesting to see in the future if other fields are able to adopt so open approach. But other things have been done pretty much in different research groups. If we think about the whole circle then, so then in the planning stage of the study, now if you think about the Academy of Finland like research funding, I was just when submitting a proposal again, so I was thinking that how funny the system is. 10% of the proposals are being funded in the end, roughly. Might be a bit higher number in different groups or under different themes, but 10%. So 90% of the research proposals, research ideas that we sort of elaborate fairly far, those are neglected. And nobody knows what we have been proposing. I might have had a super great idea which didn't get funded, and the guy next to me in the second room might have had the same idea. Academy of Finland has a viewing point, seeing that what other people, what research groups have been funded, but we don't get much back that information. We don't know what is thought, what is sort of planned, and who could be collaborating. What if the research questions would be posed more openly? Not only in the research funding phase, but also in planning of the actual study once the funding is there. And I so admire some of my colleagues from Viikki faculty, Henna Fabritius here, for example. This is in Finnish, but I guess most of you understand it, that they say immediately when they got funding, not before though, but when they got funding, they said that we got funding, these are the things that we try to be advancing, do you have any ideas? What would be important, what should we be focusing on, in addition of course to their own thinking, what they were thinking that they want to be doing. So they wanted to open their research questions for evaluation at the very beginning, so that they could then be thinking that what is the most clever way of doing, thinking that you alone is not the one who knows maybe that what is needed. You might know and you might want to be doing just that, but sometimes, especially in societally like very topical things, like in this case, so they wanted to get feedback already here and got it really well. See, we've tried a bit the same thing. We've been working with the accessibility issues and once we've been, or actually our work even before we started to apply for the funding for the first time, we met up with people who had a clear problem. It had been posed that it's really difficult to be understanding and analyzing urban accessibility and to be doing urban plans like Yleiskaava, the general plan that was approved yesterday for Helsinki region, because there's no measures that would be comparable for different modes of transportation, say public transportation, car, bike. What is the accessibility pattern if you don't only think of private cars, as has been the tradition? And that there are no tools for this. And then we started to go through the literature, scientific literature, and notice that indeed there's pretty little research on that being done, and even less adoption of that in the practical work. And I think that some of the questions that we then got in these discussions were really crucial for our work, and therefore made maybe also some of the results that we were able to create more useful for those who then need to be doing practical work or need to be doing further research on the topic. And this is something where I would so like to see that new mechanisms would be created from us researchers onwards, that how could we be discussing about our study plans already better. Then for collection of data, there of course one of the crucial things thinking about the whole flow of research is that we can't be fully open in the process if we base our research on non-open data. And often one has to do so anyway, for privacy issues, for just data access issues, that if you want to be answering to an important question, you simply don't have open data available for the purpose, or even accessible data, such that wouldn't be filling the full criteria of open data. So often you need to be giving up your principles on this, but I think that it's when you have two data sources available and you need to be choosing from two, so then openness is something where we should be maybe paying even more attention than we do now. A challenge here is some experience that we had, for example, in the biodiversity or CIBIC, this biodiversity informatics group, was that we had this idea in our mind. We wanted to do all the research that we do with open data sources so that those could be repeated by others and could be published with the full set of data, full set of methods, and then the actual publication. And then we aimed high nevertheless. We wanted to be publishing in highest impact journals, and we made a global big analysis that was published in Nature in the end, which is not open at all, unfortunately, so we gave up our principles in there. And while doing so, in the last minutes of the thing, what we learned was that even if the data sets that we had been sort of downloading from the internet that said that those are available for freely available for research purposes, so we couldn't have been using those. So we were in a conference where those issues, so expansion of global protected area network in the world, was discussed by 4,000 experts. And we had made an analysis where that expansion should be taking place and how do different approaches influence the result, and what, like, very crucial things for the discussion. Nature had been agreeing to be publishing the work, and on those days, then they send an email that, well, we can't go online with the work because you have been using these data sources that are not available for commercial purposes. So the license was such for those data sets that, yes, you could have been using them for non-commercial purposes research, but Nature is not non-commercial organization. It's very much commercial organization, as you know. And therefore, we needed to be starting to ask permissions for all the data sets on that very last minute from organizations like IUCN, which is the World Conservation Union, huge organization, WWF, and sort of 10 others. And then sitting in a conference in Australia and trying to call, write emails, and be panicking about that was very good learning experience on what is really open. So something which is not for commercial purposes can be then, even in the research world, considered non-eligible data. Then, of course, in the end, everything went smoothly, and we got the permission saying that Nature paper coming out, can you react quickly? So then they did. But it wasn't very pleasant experience, But thereafter, also these organizations have changed their practices. So now they say better what they aim at when they provide the license. So they can be used for scientific publications as well. So we are learning all the time. Maybe other thing in the thinking about the data sources is that somehow I think that when especially we use data which is collected by others, collected by citizens, collected by volunteers, we are obliged to be sharing our results. And that is sort of putting pressure on us. So if we make others work for us, so then we need to be working for them as well and sharing the resources. Well then, analyzing data, that I suppose I said already that what seems to be now the state of the art, but maybe some of the skills are still lacking, is especially on those fields where computers, quantitative approaches are being used, where things can be coded. So to be sort of forwarding the culture of sharing your code, sharing your tools, sharing your results in the form of the code that you have been developing. So sharing basically your methods in as transparent mode as possible. Again, we can argue that if we share our results, so then somebody could be taking them and be using them for other purposes. But isn't that the purpose in the end? That somebody might be taking our research results, research methods, and be advancing them further. And therefore, for example, GitHub as a service seems to be increasingly common between or within those groups who are doing quantitative work just for their own version control, but of course increasingly also openly, so that you share with others the work that you're at the moment doing, or at least when you publish the publish your tools or analysis, so then you share your code there as well. This takes time. It's not always as simple as one could think, for the reason that then of course when sharing to others you need to be documenting things better, you need to be thinking how beautifully you make your analysis and so on. But what we've learned is that actually it helps us most, because then after half a year when you need to be coming back to the actual work and you have forgotten all the details, if you have documented the work as if you would be telling it to someone else, so then it's also helpful for you yourself. So that applies to many things. Many open science practices are actually just practices of good science, and that applies to the analysis, documenting and sharing analysis methods as well. Well, then about reporting the results, that's of course obvious, academic publications in open access platform, but in case they are available so that the actual publication is available, the methods are available and the data is available, there's a more high likelihood that those could be really taken into the societal discussion as well and be used in broader circles than one originally even thought of. Then if we think about the distribution of research and the further steps, so there, I suppose there's plenty of examples of using different open platforms and being open, and this is something that very much we need to be emphasizing. Just want to be highlighting one thing here as an example for the mentioned nature work, as there was a 6-month embargo time for the publication, and we didn't want to be respecting that, but didn't want to be breaking the rules too much either. So then CSC was luckily available to help us to create a platform where we could be presenting our results in a interactive way, so that anyone can browse. Well, the mouse doesn't work now to show you that, but there's a site where there's a story page where the reader is taken through the Nature article. So basically you don't need to read the paper, you need to read our presentation about it if you want to understand what's happening in there. And then all the data sets are available so that you can be interactively zooming the maps, viewing the maps, comparing the maps, zooming to the statistics and analyzing them further yourself visually as well. And then of course you can download the resulting data and continue analysis from there if you wish. And I think that these services that we have at the moment available are helping to distribute our work in a new way and a bit go around those regulations that there are in the publishing in case we can't be publishing fully open. Then of course the last part, so how are the results valued, do they make a difference, varies a lot on the question at hand and how the research is, what are the topics and how the research is being conducted and what is happening in the society at the moment when the research work starts to be close to ending. I'll give just an example from the accessibility work that we have been carrying out and what we think that we have been getting from using openly available data sources as the basic of the work and then sharing our tools and results throughout the process. And somehow I think that what we've seen around us, so this is not something that we've been doing, we've seen somebody taking our stuff and develop better tools. That has been happening. So regardless of us, but we've said that you can use our tools if you share your own result. So then those are available again for everyone. We've seen many consultant reports that are using our tools, which we think are better than the previous ones that were used for the same purpose. And of course, we are happy for that. We've seen that active citizens have been taking the tools' approaches and been developing their own thinking and proposals, for example, for the current general plan with different approaches than was used by others. Official plans are adopting them as well. And then, of course, in teaching and capacity building within university, but also outside university, it's really nice that you can be sort of building a teaching module on real scientific data and still distribute it freely. And that has been happening. And then, of course, I think we've been receiving some more funding for the reason of using this sort of approach, which has been supportive for others. And all in all, I think that if we think about broader picture, this has generated new knowledge regardless of us and our capacities to be doing it. It has added maybe efficiency to our work, certainly quality, because our work has been examined very in detail as everything has been shared, so then all the shortcuts we've been taking have been visible, and hopefully some better decisions and business innovations are being happening here at the same time. And we've seen a lot surprising things, so something happening which we didn't expect that our results could be used for. Small things, but bigger things as well, and that is somehow interesting. One of the things that we've been following, not much, so much participating even, is really the general plan and the huge debate on to whom the city is being planned at the moment for. Is it for those who are driving a private car, or is it for those who are using public transportation? And without going even to that question, the fact that you even can analyze what do these different modes of transportation mean for accessibility, which is our study subject, is something that you can provide real information on this and then make the decisions with that knowledge, hopefully. So somehow I think that in addition indeed of thinking open access publishing, open access methods and open access data, it would be really great if we could be sort of moving forward and trying to be thinking that how, from the very beginning to the very end, we could be supporting open research, open science. There are often arguments saying something against it, but that it takes time, and it does take time. But as the examples previously showed, at least we think that we have been sort of getting back the investments that we have made for for being open, the time investments and maybe also those investments that somebody has been taking our ideas of research and executing them quicker than we have. But then, of course, if we think about the bigger goal of trying to create something relevant for the society, it's good if somebody is quick and if there's more people in there working on those issues than only us. What we've learned is clearly, and this is that we've learned like the hard way, that it would be easiest to be thinking these from early on, like when starting the work, but it hasn't been that in our case. We've been learning all the time and still are. But now as things go forward and there's more support available, so of course the future researchers and research projects can be starting to be thinking about these issues early on. Help is already available, but actually help needs to be available for the researchers to be able to conduct open science practices. I think that in the future sometimes we face the situation where everyone knows how to do things by their basic researcher education, but yet it's not the case. So people would like to maybe be doing things openly, but they don't know how to do it in practice. And there's lots of law issues or like legislative issues, there's lots of technical issues and just missing knowledge about the whole process. And therefore I think that developing further the training and the support system is very much needed. And that's indeed already happening as we speak. So is openness the way forward? Is I guess that it's obvious that I think that it might be, and especially I think it is the only way forward if we want to be somehow be able to react on these relevant big issues in the world that are happening. So we must be faster. We must be more in collaboration than has been. Maybe the case before. And openness of the research process is one way of advancing this. But still, as we think about the things to change, there are these practical things, support that can be given, practical things can be changed. So then at the same time, I think that one thing that we should be changing at the same time is the merit system of the scientific world. If we want to be answering the big questions, it's at the moment a bit sort of wag the dog situation, so häntä heiluttaa koiraa, that the merit system, which should be the end of it, is actually defining how we do some of our things, and not that ideology of changing the world and making it better and answering to really big questions. And therefore, this has to be fixed in addition to all the other technical and like supportive and culture questions. And there are ways of doing this, like maybe this discussion today, and then of course other research orientated and then administration orientated open science groups. And there I would like to stop.